exultant sacred music for a king who identified himself with the sun and faced his bedroom to the east so that one mighty being could gaze upon another. The king was Louis XIV of France, and the music was by Francois Couperin, whose harpsichord pieces have long ensured his fame, but whose sacred works have been virtually forgotten. In recent years, the Couperin explorers have shown us two things. First, that the religious works include his greatest masterpieces. And second, how they reflect the demands of the king's declining years. Indeed, once Louis's long reign was over, its paraphernalia packed away, and the great sun finally set, Couperin, though he long survived, wrote sacred music no more. At the Saturday flea market in Paris's Place des Petits Pères, the search is on for hidden treasures. No one glances at the house where Couperin spent the last years of his life and died in 1733. And there is no commemorative plaque. But the elusive figure of the composer is gradually being restored to its proper recognition. Thus, in a back room of the Louvre, this 18th century copper etching was recently used to produce Couperin's portrait by the original method. Having covered the plate with ink, then rubbed it off and polished the surface so that the ink remains only in the etched grooves, the printer covers it with a sheet of thick, very damp paper. Pressure now forces the moist paper into the grooves, taking up the precise ink pattern of the image. The crisp and powerful result is as striking a visual revelation of Couperin as that which has lately illuminated his music. The Paris into which Couperin was born in 1668 was dominated then as now by the island cathedral of Notre Dame. Opposite stood the oldest church on the right bank, Saint-Gervais, recently embellished with an up-to-date classical facade. Here, in the heart of the old city, one family of musicians lived next to the church and held the post of organist for nearly 200 years. Les Couperin, a musical dynasty second only to that of Bach in Germany. When Couperin was 10, his father died. In his teens, he duly succeeded to the post of organist at Saint-Gervais, and at 20 he married. Apart from one other hasty signature, the marriage contract contains Couperin's only surviving handwriting. His and his bride's initials appear at the foot of each page, as demanded by the complexities of French law, with, finally, their full signatures among a jostling crowd of witnesses. His, just above the bold scrawl of his uncle, the senior Couperin present. That uncle, also a Francois, and also an organist, was later killed in a traffic accident near the great facade of Saint-Gervais. In the following centuries, Parisian traffic has waged a long battle with Couperin, since the organ he played sits just above the street, behind the central window. The best-known recent book on Couperin states that this organ does not survive in playable condition. In fact, not only is it playable, but it fills the church with a 17th-century tone color. And although over the years it has suffered neglect, alteration, and war damage, it retains several stops used by Couperin.
Voilà, alors là, nous sommes à l'intérieur de l'orgue, du grand buffet, du moins.
This is amazing, to be actually inside this most famous of all organs. I've dreamed for a long time of coming in here. I've lived in Paris for many years, but never been in. And Couperin would have known many of these pipes.
Voilà, alors par exemple, vous avez ici ce jeu-là, qui est le jeu de voix humaine, qui date de l'époque de Couperin, qui est antérieure d'ailleurs, mais que Couperin a connu, bien sûr.
It dates from Couperin's time, but is even older. It's wonderful to think that Couperin himself would have actually come up here many times and tuned it.
Absolument.
And up
puis,
here?
Alors, cette fameuse trompette qui est maintenant à l'écho.
This is the famous trumpet of 1714.
Voilà, c'est ça.
Ça, c'est vraiment fantastique de voir ça. Extraordinaire. Ce que j'ai vraiment envie de faire, ayant vu tous les tuyaux, c'est d'aller jouer quelque chose en utilisant ces sons que Couperin lui-même a utilisés. I'd love to try something, actually using these pipes that Couperin himself has installed. Perhaps we can play one of the trumpet
Allons-y.
Pieces.
Music from a book of pieces designed to alternate with the plain song of the Mass was written when Couperin was 20. No further organ collections survive, but it was as an organist that he now received the greatest boost to his career, a place at court. Couperin and the new Versailles were roughly of an age. At the time of the composer's birth, Louis XIV had just begun the 50-year task of transforming his father's modest hunting lodge into something more suitable to his self-esteem. By the time Couperin was 20, 40,000 workmen had reshaped the Versailles landscape, diverting a tiresome river, removing an inconvenient village, and building the greatest palace in the world. In the earlier days, the music was the music of Lully, who revived Louis's famous bands. The full court complement of 20,000 people was served by 8 permanent orchestras, an opera house, 2 choirs, and 4 organists. In 1693, an organist died, and the king, who took a personal interest in all such matters, chose the 24-year-old Couperin to fill the gap. Later compositions, such as this, Les Petits Moulins à Vent, The Little Windmills, remind us of the wit and gaiety that were now at the disposal of the royal pupils. Among them, the king's eldest grandson, the Duke of Burgundy, whom Couperin taught for 12 years. Joining the throng of court society was the most important step in the composer's career. The salary and the forthcoming ennoblement established him for life. But if the harpsichord has ensured Couperin's fame, the king's chief task for him has been strangely forgotten: the provision of sacred music for services, which were held at this time in a temporary chapel in one of the great rooms. And here, Couperin demonstrated the paradox of his art. For in a milieu of unparalleled ostentation, he achieved his eminence through the smallest and sparsest of musical means. Motet, from a group of works only rediscovered in 1970, tells us that at one level, the restrained intimacy of Couperin's art was clearly a matter of personal temperament, which is traceable in many of his works. Many years later, he was to write this musical self-portrait. Its gravity and elegant sadness worlds away from court frivolity. Perfectly capable of virtuosity when needed, he preferred, he said, that which moves me to that which astonishes me. And this was the vein that so impressed Bach, who corresponded with Couperin, although the letters later disappeared, apparently after the family had used them as jam pot covers. But But historians now know that the king's increasing age also had something to do with the small scale of Couperin's works. It was 40 years since the young Louis had appeared as the sun itself in the Ballet de Nuit, 40 years since he'd ridden triumphantly at the siege of Dunkirk. It was 30 years since he had sat confidently at the founding of the Academy of Science. And it was fully a quarter of a century since Nocre had painted him as Apollo, crowned with laurel. After his marriage to the pious Madame de Maintenon, a gloomier air enveloped the court. And with the passing of the years, visitors noticed that the Sun King took on a wintry aspect. He quarreled with his priests, interfered with the order of service, and turned increasingly to smaller musical forms which could express both the elegant standards of his secular world and its ornate religious intensity. The demands of this contradiction seem not to have troubled Couperin, who duly supplied fine music to the stream of humdrum texts for routine saints' days, rarely using more than four or five people for his great effects. By 1709, the grand completion of Louis's Versailles was near, with the final touches being put to its last component, the great chapel we know today. But in 1709 came also the first of a series of disasters in the autumn of the king's reign. And Couperin, who had come to court when Le Roi Soleil still blazed, now found that it would be his special duty to solace that setting sun in the days of its decline. In 1713, Couperin published his first collection of harpsichord pieces. Among them is a weighty rondo in a minor key, constructed from a grave recurring phrase and a series of interludes which attempt a livelier vein before the regretful theme inevitably reasserts itself. Its mood was apt for a period when melancholy was gradually overwhelming the court. In 1709, France had suffered the hardest winter it had ever known, with the great frost causing starvation, epidemic, army setbacks, and the collapse of trade. Scarcely had the country recovered than the king's family faced a disaster that threatened the seemingly impregnable succession. Louis had not only a son, but a grandson, and a great-grandson too. Within 11 months, all three were dead. Louis's son, the Grand Dauphin, was the first to die, succumbing to smallpox in 1711. The same disease claimed his son next, Duke of Burgundy, and his wife. And they in turn were followed to the grave by their son, the 5-year-old Duke of Brittany. The state funerals reflected an immense wave of mourning throughout France, focused especially upon the younger couple and their child. When it was published, this piece was entitled La Favorite. There is no actual evidence that it commemorates the Duke of Burgundy, Couperin's old pupil, by remembering the various delightful aspects of his life within a recurrent framework of mourning. But some have taken this to be its meaning, and though they may be strictly wrong, in a broader sense they have not mistaken the tragic feeling of the piece. King's melancholy increased, deepened by the deaths of old friends and young relatives. Now in his mid-70s, he began to show signs of the disease that was to culminate in senile gangrene, and which by gloomy chance has made the wax model of his head so realistic. Couperin himself was now middle-aged, and through natural reticence had achieved none of the 8 main musical posts at court. His mood matched the king's, in its preference for unassertive chamber groups, and he now produced a set of instrumental suites for Sunday concerts after church, Les Concerts Royaux, by which title he tells us they were known at the court in 1714 and 15, the last 2 years of the king's life. written specifically to soothe the king's tristesse, these delicate confections, musical equivalents of Claude and Watteau, aim to beguile their listener by suggesting another sphere of existence, a pastoral world of shepherds, dance, and perpetual summer evening. If that has the glow of secular music with a Sunday face, it was a more austere world that commanded Couperin's next and greatest work, Les Leçons de Ténèbres, for his favorite soprano voices. These were settings of the mournful lessons for Tenebrae, the nighttime service of Holy Week, which was marked by a ritual of gradually extinguishing the candles, even though for convenience it had come to be held late on the previous afternoon. In the Christian liturgy, the lessons for Tenebrae were drawn from the Book of Lamentations, whose agony for the fall of Jerusalem was seen as a parallel to humanity's mourning for Christ's suffering. So intense is the mood that Couperin builds in a petite pause for calming meditation between each verse. In the original Hebrew Bible, Lamentations was written on an acrostic pattern, each verse beginning with a successive letter of the Hebrew alphabet, either as a memory aid or a poetic discipline. In the Latin versions of the Bible, those Hebrew letters, which were now strictly meaningless, were often placed alongside the verse numbers. And in some vernacular Bibles, they were even transliterated and left as confusing syllables in the margin. Whether or not Couperin knew the origin of those Hebrew letters, he now used them to ingenious structural effect. His third, Leçon, begins with the letter Yod at the 10th verse of chapter 1. Here, and at each point where the succeeding Hebrew letters occur, Couperin allows the two soprano voices to rise in a wordless pattern of soaring phrases, weaving, clashing, and resolving. A further ethereal interlude between each anguished verse. The king struggled to every Tenebrae service during the last Easter of his life and must have known this work. But for once, its origin lay in a different religious atmosphere from that at court. It was written for nuns. In Couperin's own words, at the request of the religious ladies of L, which is thought to have been the now vanished convent of Longchamp near Paris. For here, a curious tradition had grown up, whereby at this time of year, when the opera houses were closed, the nuns invited famous professional singers to come and perform at their services. They have made of their church a theater, exclaimed Madame de Maintenon. In fact, what they had done was to provide Couperin with the finest possible vehicle for his art, an art whose civilized decorum now proved itself capable of bringing forth one of the most passionate of all religious masterpieces.
Did it all.